Yeah, and now I'm so excited to turn the evening towards Monica Youn's reading, and I'll introduce her and then Monica can take it from there. At any given moment, there's usually a Monica Youn poem running through my mind, though one in particular lives there rent-free, the brief and devastating poem titled Palinode that comes before the text proper of Blackacre. Often upon waking, I will think about this poem, which is an alarming way to wake up and one of the only ways I know how. Palinode, with a Greek etymology meaning backwards song, to me signals the myth of master lyrist Orpheus and Eurydice, which seems apt as Monica is a student and destroyer of myth, and in fact has written on Orpheus and Eurydice in her recent studies of two figures. She engages the myth and the archetype and applies pressure to them as they do to us in order to expose the systems of hierarchy and power operating underneath. And what I think I love about Palinode is that for me, it encapsulates nearly everything I crave from Monica's work and from poetry at large. I mean, her work is a poetry of analysis, of perspective and encounter, in which thought is pitted against parataxic thought and dared or demanded or repelled, perhaps even threatened, into thinking to and with and through each other and to and with and through us. As lyrical as they are analytical, Monica Youn's poems are gravid, serious, witty, sarcastic, and heart-stopping and breaking. A beautiful, restless poetics and poetics that frankly just doesn't fuck around. Reading her work is an exercise in attention, a staring contest with the act of thought itself. To me, the experience of reading her work is best explained as a direct command, and in her own words, from the poem Ignatz Pop Quiz, quote, "Tell me when you can feel this." Monica Youn is the author of Blackacre, which won the William Carlos Williams Award of the Poetry Society of America. It was also shortlisted for the National Book Critics Circle Award and the Kingsley Tufts Award, longlisted for the National Book Award, and named one of the best poetry books of 2016 by the New York Times, the Washington Post, and BuzzFeed. Her previous book, Ignatz, was a finalist for the National Book Award. She has been awarded the Levinson Prize from the Poetry Foundation, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a Witter Bytter Fellowship from the Library of Congress, and a Stegner Fellowship, among other honors. A former lawyer and a member of the Racial Imaginary Institute, she teaches at Princeton and in the MFA programs at NYU and Columbia. And I'm so excited now to turn it over to you, Monica.
I'm so happy to be here. I'm especially happy to hear myself described as a destroyer of myth, because I'm really hopeful that that means that I get a suit of armor and maybe some arrows and maybe someone who will show me how to use some arrows, which has always been my fantasy. I am incredibly happy to have heard Arda, especially the new work. And I'm waiting for the book to come out, as are we all. My poems are, I guess depressing is not quite the word, but on potentially depressing subjects, but mine don't include genocide. They're just depressing in other ways. So I'm gonna read three books. I just today got my contract for my forthcoming book, which is called From, and will be forthcoming from Graywolf in March 2023, assuming I'm able to finish it, which remains to be seen as a pandemic single parent. But I thought I would read three poems. Two of which are quite long, and I'll read a really short one in the middle, so it'll be kind of like a butter sandwich made on a, you know, on a Kaiser roll or something like that. It's going to be mostly surroundings. And this first one, thank you so much for that introduction. That was, you know, just a hold it to my heart. This first one is, in fact, involves one mythology, one history. The first mythological figure is called Pasiphae. Those of you who follow Greek mythology might know that she is the queen of Crete, the wife of King Minos. I think sort of importantly, she comes from a family of witches out of Colchis, which is in present day Turkey. And the family of witches includes a lot of, you know, the femme fatale figures of Greek mythology, Medea, Phaedra, Circe, all of them are members of this particular family of witches. Pasiphae is in there as well. And she is mostly known because basically the god sent a white bull from the sea, and her husband, King Minos, was supposed to sacrifice the bull to the gods, and instead he kept the bull for his own herds, and the gods were angry and they punished him by punishing his wife making her fall in love with the bull. And so she commanded the inventor Daedalus, who was then working for them, to make a mechanical cow for her, a wooden cow. And so she crouches inside the cow, is impregnated by the bull, and eventually gives birth to the monster, the Minotaur, who is imprisoned in the labyrinth, which itself is also created by Daedalus, and is eventually killed by the Greek hero Theseus. The other figure is from Korean history, from 17th, 18th century Korean history, Crown Prince Sado. And Crown Prince Sado, and you know, in Korean history, he's one of the great tragic figures. He is, you know, Crown Prince. He marries this amazing woman named Lady Hyegyeong, from whose memoirs we know a lot of this history. And then he goes insane. He goes homicidally insane. And he has an heir first. And he kills, rapes and kills probably about 100 people, courtiers. And since he is the crown prince, there's really very little that anyone can do about this. And even the king is constrained, because if the king executes Sado, then the entire bloodline would be considered tainted. And so there would be no line of succession, there would be no heir. If he declared him insane, arguably, if Sado had killed himself, the same result would have obtained. There would be no line of succession, there would be no heir. And so what the king does is, on a July day in Seoul, he asks Sado to come before him and to apologize for his crimes, which he does. The king asked for a rice chest to be brought, and a rice chest is a wooden box. It's about 4 feet by 4 feet by 3 feet. And he asked for Sado to get into the rice chest, and he closes the rice chest. For some reason, has grass piled on top. And then about 8 days later, Sado dies. Study of two figures, Pasiphae, Sado. One figure is female, the other is male. Both are contained. One figure is mythical, the other historical. To the extent that one can be said to have existed at all, they occupy different millennia, different continents. But to the extent that one can be said to have existed at all, both figures are considered Asian, one from Colchis, one from Korea. To mention the Asianness of the figures creates a racial marker in the poem. This means that the poem can no longer pass as a white poem, that different people can be expected to read the poem, that they can be expected to read the poem in different ways. To mention the Asianness of the figures is also to mention, by implication, the Asianness of the poet. Revealing a racial marker in a poem is like revealing a gun in a story, or like revealing a nipple in a dance. After such a revelation, the poem is about race, the story is about the gun, the dance is about the body of the dancer. It is no longer considered a dance at all and is subject to regulation. Topics that have this gravitational quality of aboutness are known as hot button topics, such as race, violence, or sex. Hot button is a marketing term coined by Walter Kitchell III in a September 1978 issue of Fortune magazine. The term evokes laboratory animals and refers to consumer desires that need to be slaked. The term hot button suggests not only the slaking of such desires, but also a shock or punishment for having acted on such desires, a deterrent to further actions pursuing such desires, and by extension, a deterrent to desire itself. Violence and sex are examples of desires and can be satisfied, punished, and deterred. Race is not usually considered an example of desire. Both the male and the female figures are able to articulate their desires with an unusual degree of candor and specificity. Both are responsible for many sexual deaths. The male figure says, "When anger grips me, I cannot contain myself. Only after I kill something, a person, perhaps an animal, even a chicken, can I calm down. I'm sad that your majesty does not love me and terrified when you criticize me. All this turns to anger. Your majesty here refers to the king, his father." The female figure is never directly quoted, but Pseudo-Apollodorus writes that she casts a spell upon the king, her husband, so that when he has sex with another woman, he ejaculates wild creatures into the woman's vagina, thereby killing her. Although the punishment is enacted on the body of the woman, this punishment is meant to deter the king from slaking his desires. Both figures are figures of excessive desire, requiring containment. Both containers are wooden. Both containers are camouflage with a soft, yielding substance, one with grass, one with fur. Both containers are ingenious solutions to seemingly intractable problems. One problem is political, one problem is sexual. They are both the same problem. They have the same solution. The male figure waits in the container for death to come. He waits for 8 days. His son will live. This ensures the succession, the frictionless transfer of power. The female figure waits in the container for the generation of life. We do not know how long she waits. Her son will die after waiting in his own wooden container. This ensures the succession, the frictionless transfer of power. There are many artistic representations of both containers. The male figure's container is blockish, unadorned, a household object of standard size and quotidian function. Tourists climb into it and pose for photos, post them online. The cramped position of their bodies generates a combination of horror and glee. This in turn creates discomfort, the recognition that horror and glee should not be combined, that such a combination is taboo. The female figure's container is customized, lushly contoured. Its contours are excessively articulated to the same degree that her desire is excessively articulated. Artists depict the container in cutaway view, revealing the female figure within awaiting the wild creature. The abject position of the female figure on all fours, pressing her genitalia back against the hollow cow's genitalia, generates a combination of lust and revenge. This in turn creates discomfort, the recognition that lust and revenge should not be combined, that wild creatures and female figures should not be combined, but these combinations are taboo. The tourist can climb into the rice chest. The tourist can pose for a photo in the rice chest. Then the tourist can climb out of the rice chest and walk away. The artist can look into the hollow cow. The artist can render the contours of the hollow cow, the contours of the female figure. Then the artist can walk away. Both containers allow the tourist and artist to touch the hot button, the taboo. The desire and the discomfort remain contained. Both containers allow the tourist and the artist to walk away. The male and female figures remain contained. Neither container, the rice chest, the hollow cow, appears to have any necessary connection to race. To mention race, or it is not necessary to mention race, is taboo. I have not mentioned the race of the tourist or the artist. The tourist and the artist are allowed to pass for white. The tourist and the artist are not contained. I have already mentioned the race of the poet, but to the extent that the poet is not contained, the poet is allowed to pass for white. I have already mentioned the race of the male and female figures. The male and female figures are contained. The rice chest and the hollow cow are containers. The rice chest and the hollow cow are not the only containers in this poem. Colchis and Korea are containers in this poem. Asianness is a container in this poem. Race is a container in this poem. Each of these containers contains desire and its satisfaction. Each of these containers contains discomfort and deterrence. Each of these containers contains a hot button, a taboo. The tourist and the artist can enter each of these containers. The tourist and the artist can touch the hot button and walk away. Each of these containers separates the slaking of desire from the punishment of desire. Each of these containers is an ingenious solution to a seemingly intractable problem. They are the same problem, they have the same solution. Each of these containers ensures the frictionless transfer of power. Each of these containers holds a male or female figure. The name of the male figure can be translated as, "Think of me in sadness." The name of the female figure can be translated as, "I shine for all of you." Okay, now a much shorter poem in much shorter lines, as I have a sip of my drink. And this is a poem that's an homage, a little bit of homage or a formal homage to Martha Collins. And this is Leave. It is leave in both senses, like to get out of here, especially the Brexit sense of get out of here, and also leave, to put forth leaves. Leave. Because it is to create an acute angle, an angle shaped like a wedge, because it is to give birth to what you already know to be expendable after it is cleaned, after it has fed you, because you are enriched by even its deterioration, because the join might seem slender like a throat, because the bud might seem tender like a bud, but in this tenderness you do not share anything. Because even the join is also a jam, a harbinger of scab, a rust-red portal that shuts down what it depletes, that shuts out the obsolete, because you keep what is inside from seeping out, because you keep what is outside from slipping in, because in the singular and as a noun, you are a form of formal permission, as in why don't you make like a tree and... Okay, now short break from, okay, so this is an homage to C.V. Wright's practice of occasionally taking a detail, or, you know, she has this poem, What No One Could Have Told Them, and then detail from What No One Could Have Told Them, which is this wonderful kind of remix of like Brecht peeing into a paper plate when he was a baby, which is fantastic. But Brecht, their child, not Brecht, the other. But anyways, this is also, so I took a detail from the previous very long poem that I just read and made it into an even longer poem. So, and then we will be done. All right, and then I will have a drink. Here goes, folks. And may I just say, I'm so happy to be here. So nice to be in this community again. Even a virtual forum, I really like, you know, I'm enjoying the chat. I'm enjoying like seeing so many of my friends' names up on the screen and, you know, in person. It's lovely. Okay, detail of the rice chest. In the 2015 Korean film, The Throne, the rice chest sits in the center of the vast symmetrical courtyard of Changyungdong Palace. The film is called The Throne in English. In Korean, it is called Sado. A Korean-speaking audience would be presumed to know in advance who Prince Sado was. An English-speaking audience is presumed not to have this knowledge. Although this is a historical film, for a Korean-speaking audience, the well-known story functions as mythology at the level of symbol. For an English-speaking audience, the unknown story functions as narrative at the level of plot. There is an I in this poem. I know who Prince Sado is.
I can read the Hangul word sado, but I do not speak Korean. I am a member of the English-speaking audience. I know about Prince Sado from the memoirs of Lady Hyegyeong, 1804, but I know about the memoirs of Lady Hyegyeong from Margaret Drabble's The Red Queen, 2004. Margaret Drabble's The Red Queen is about Lady Hyegyeong, but Lady Hyegyeong was never a queen, nor is she associated with the color red. The name is misleading. The name of the film, The Throne, is also misleading. The film does not focus on the throne. It focuses on the rice chest. Like a magnifying glass, the stone courtyard focuses the gaze on the rice chest. The gaze increases in intensity and heat. July temperatures in Seoul average 84 degrees Fahrenheit, with average humidity of 78%. I have been to Seoul in July. I have worn hanbok on a summer day, but only once. I've never seen a rice chest. The rice chest is a functional object and stands in contrast to the highly decorative architecture of the palace courtyard. Its plainness renders it inscrutable, impenetrable. According to the website Things Korean, the rice chest always looks chock full. There are always these four pillars at its corners, which seem to be holding up a massive roof, as if this were some imposing religious edifice. Because of its oversized lid, the rice chest appears top-heavy, charged with kinetic potential. On its four small feet, it seems to be crouching on its haunches, to be hunkering down. Hunker down is a Scottish term that refers to squatting on the balls of one's feet low to the ground but in readiness. It implies an apprehensive stasis, tense with the potential for sudden movement, poised to flee or to attack. I have hunkered down, but only once. Midway through the film, the rice chest is bound with thick rope, with a knotted webbing of four or five thicknesses of coarse, fibrous rope. The quantity of rope exceeds the function of the rope to such an extent that the rope binding seems decorative, symbolic. I have been bound with rope, but only once. There is something almost comic about such an excess of rope to bind a single imprisoned and dying man, the way there is something almost comic about a circle of guns pointed at a single unarmed man. I say almost comic rather than actually comic, because although these images provoke the same pent-up tension as suppressed laughter, I do not know who would find either of these images funny. After it is bound, the lid of the rice chest is heaped with grass. For a Korean-speaking audience, the grass-covered rice chest would resemble a traditional grassy burial mound, would evoke ancestral tombs, or even the prehistoric dolmens, which feature massive rocks perched on four small feet. I have seen the grassy burial mounds of my ancestors, but only once. For me, the rope-clad, grass-covered rice chest resembles a barbarian idol. According to the online etymological dictionary, the word barbarian comes originally from the Greek, meaning any non-Greek, but under the Romans, barbarian took on a derogatory connotation, those who speak a language different from one's own. When I say barbarian, it means I find the rice chest foreign, inscrutable, although it is Korean. Koreans speak a language different from my own. In the film, the walls of the rice chest are made with thick planks, with chinks between them that admit slim shafts of light, drips of water. But the walls of Korean rice chests are made of solid panels of wood. Planks with chinks between them would admit pests, especially insects, into the rice chest. Such a rice chest design would not be functional. Partway through the film, we see a multi-legged insect enter the rice chest through a chink between the boards. We here refers to both the English-speaking and Korean-speaking audiences. The single insect is followed by a horde of identical multi-legged insects wriggling through the chinks in the walls. We understand the insects to be a hallucination of the dying Prince Sado. Their function is symbolic, the danger of allowing chinks in the walls. In the film, through the chinks in the walls, Prince Sado is able to see and to speak to his dog and to his 10-year-old son, the grand heir. But in fact, these incidents never took place. They are not hallucinations, but fabrications of the filmmakers, just as the multi-legged insects, the chinks in the walls of the rice chest, are fabrications of the filmmakers. windows. The chinks allow the gaze to penetrate what would otherwise be impenetrable, to penetrate the barbaric figure of the rice chest, to reach the human inside. In A Midsummer Night's Dream, which is familiar to both Korean and English-speaking audiences, Tom Snout, a rude mechanical, plays the part of a wall that features a crannied hole or chink. The joke is that a human being portrays an inhuman object, since only an inhuman object would feature such a chink. I do not know who would find this joke funny. When asked to show me thy chink, Tom Snout holds up two fingers. I have seen boys hold up two fingers. Calling me a chink, they would place their two fingers at the corners of their eyes, stretching their eyes into narrow slits through which it must have been difficult to see. They found this joke funny. I've seen men hold up two fingers. They would use their tongues to penetrate the chink between their fingers, rendering the gesture obscene. The tongue thrust between the fingers reads as sexual, whereas an out-thrust tongue without the fingers would be merely rude. Neither gesture is intended to be funny. Both the boys and the men would use their two fingers to symbolize my body, a body that, without a chink, might seem impenetrable. The primary meaning of the English word chink is a split or crack, a narrow fissure or valley. It is related to the old German root germ, as in germinate, the connection being in the notion of bursting open, as the online etymological dictionary explains. Chink also has a racially derogatory meaning, referring to a Chinese person or by extension to any East Asian person, since an English-speaking person using a racially derogatory term would not be expected to differentiate among East Asian people. I have asked boys to differentiate among East Asian people. Upon being called a chink, I would say, "You're so stupid. I'm not a chink. I'm a gook." The Korean-American comedian Margaret Cho later used a similar statement as a punchline to a joke. I find this joke funny, and some members of a Korean-speaking audience might find this joke funny. I do not know whether other members of an English-speaking audience would find this joke funny. The term gook was used by English-speaking soldiers to refer to Korean people during the Korean War. It was later used by English-speaking soldiers to refer to Vietnamese people during the Vietnam War, since English-speaking soldiers do not differentiate among East Asian people. The term gook derives from the Korean word for American, miguk. Hearing Korean people say this word, English-speaking soldiers thought the Korean people were calling themselves gooks, miguk, and followed suit. The word miguk in Korean literally means beautiful country. Miguk is a transliteration of the Chinese characters meguo, which also mean beautiful country. I know how to pronounce miguk, but not meguo. There are several accounts of why meguo came to mean American. Some claim it's a simple phonetic approximation. Others claim that meguo was selected out of several possible phonetic approximations by 19th century American missionaries and then made official in the 1901 Boxer Protocol after China's defeat by eight Western nations. I do not know which account is true. All commentators seem to agree that neither Korean people nor Chinese people literally believe that America is a beautiful country. But both Korean people and Chinese people must call America beautiful in order to speak its name. Neither Korean people nor Chinese people refer to themselves as gooks or chinks. Neither Korean people nor Chinese people refer to themselves as Korean or Chinese. Korea is an English word that seems to derive from a mispronunciation of the name of the Goryeo dynasty by Silk Road traders and was first recorded by Marco Polo. China is an English word that seems to derive from a mispronunciation of the name of the Qin dynasty by Silk Road traders and was first recorded by Marco Polo. I have said Marco Polo's name many times in a game that requires you to say his name many times. I do not know the origin of the game. Because of the R's and L's, Marco Polo would be a difficult name for Korean speakers to say, but I am not a Korean speaker. I have called myself a gook many times. I have called myself a chink only once, when a white high school friend used the term in conversation, then stopped, realizing her gaffe. "Don't worry," I said, "I know what you mean. X is such an FOB. "What's an FOB?" she asked. "Fresh off the boat," I said. "I may be a chink, but at least I'm not an FOB." We laughed together to relieve the tension, although I do not think either of us found my joke funny. I used the term FOB to show that I considered X to be foreign, a barbarian. I called myself a chink to make myself seem more American. "Fresh off the boat" was my white husband's favorite television show during the time we were married. When we watched it, I hoped that laughing at the pushy Chinese immigrant mother on the show would lessen his dislike of my pushy Korean immigrant mother. I hoped that allowing my white husband to treat my parents as endearingly foreign, fresh off the boat, like the endearingly foreign TV family of Fresh Off the Boat, would make myself seem more American. None of the actors in Fresh Off the Boat are fresh off the boat. Almost all of them were born in America. By pretending to be foreign, they make English-speaking audiences feel more American. My parents are not fresh off the boat. They have been in America for over 50 years. They speak both Korean and English. A television is a box that allows us to put people inside it. The television is sometimes called an idiot box, from the Latin for private person, from idios, meaning one's own. But those inside the box have no privacy. We put the inscrutable into a box so they may be scrutinized. I made X inscrutable. I put X into the box. I made my parents inscrutable. I put my parents into the box. I decorated the box so it seemed foreign, barbaric. I made the box inscrutable so it seemed like a distant ancestor. I buried it so it seemed like a grave. I made a chink in the box that the gaze could penetrate. I stayed outside the box. I treated what was inside the box as a joke. I was the English speaking audience. I watched Fresh Off the Boat on the idiot box. I watched The Throne on the idiot box. In The Throne, a parent puts his son in the rice chest. After his son's death, the rice chest is forced open. After the son's death, his mouth is forced open. 3 spoonfuls of rice are forced into his mouth, rice that might have kept him from starving to death in the rice chest. After the son's death, a name is forced into his mouth. The name is Sado, a name which has meaning for Korean-speaking audiences. I have said Sado's name many times. The son never called himself Sado. There was never a chink in the rice chest. No one could see into the rice chest. There is a you in this poem. You are a member of the English-speaking audience. I let you see into the box, into what is private, into what is foreign, into what is inscrutable, into what has been buried. I am the chink in the box. Thank you.
Wow. Wow, thank you so much, Monica. That was really incredible. Unfortunately, Will's internet shorted out just before the end here, but allow me on behalf of Will and Poetry Project to thank you all for being here and spending this night with us. Thank you to Arda and Monica for an incredible reading. I just want to say that our next virtual reading is taking place next Thursday, May 6th at 8 p.m. and it's with Jasmine Gibson and Danilo Machado. So we encourage you to come back. Thank you for everyone for bearing with Zoom. I think Zoom was acting a bit weird for some people, but we really appreciate you being here. We're going to keep the chat open, so please continue to share your appreciation for our poets tonight. It was really beautiful. Thank you, and we look forward to seeing you all again soon.